Hello and welcome to Rajya Sabha Television. You're watching The Big Picture with me, Frank Rausen Pereira. Stellar performance by the Bharatiya Janata Party enabled the ruling National Democratic Alliance to attain a simple majority in the Bihar elections. Now, this despite a sharp fall in the tally of the Janata Dal United headed by Chief Minister Nitish Kumar. According to the final results announced on Wednesday, the BJP, which had contested 110 seats, won 74 seats, while the JDU, which contested in 115 seats, won only 43. While 4 seats each won by junior allies, Vikasshil Insan Party and Hindustani Awam Morcha, the NDA secured 125 seats in its kitty, 3 more than the number required for a simple majority. The opposition, the Mahagathbandhan, fell way short of the magic mark. The total number of seats won by all its 5 constituents stood at 110. However, the Rashtriya Janata Dal emerged as the single largest party in the assembly, bagging 75 seats. In this edition of The Big Picture, we will analyze the verdict of the Bihar assembly election. Joining me on the program today are Sunil K. Chaudhary, political analyst, Sanjay Kumar, director CSDS, and Nistul Ahbar, political editor of The Hindu. Thank you to all my guests for joining me on this edition of The Big Picture. All right, Sanjay Kumar, let me begin the program with you first. Let's look at the numbers in detail and what story do they tell you?
See, the detailed story is, yes, it is a neck-to-neck fight. If you look at the seat, number of seats, yes, NDA has emerged victorious. They have won 125 seats. The next government is going to be formed by NDA. But we should not forget about the vote share. Look at the vote share of Mahagathbandhan and the NDA. Both these alliances are tied up with 37.3% vote each. So the support base of political parties have remained more or less equal for both the alliances, even though the Mahagathbandhan has trailed behind NDA by about, say, 15 seats, because NDA ended up getting 125 seats and Gathbandhan ended up getting 110 seats. The overall picture which has emerged from this verdict, from this result, is that while we have been talking about voters have not voted on caste line, this was the sense we were getting during the campaign, and we thought that young voters in Bihar are going to vote cutting across caste line in favor of Mahagathbandhan. But that doesn't seem to have happened. All the political parties have actually got the votes among their core supporters, which is the support base across caste line. And parties have failed to move beyond their core supporters across caste line. That is the big picture which I see emerging from, if I go by how people have voted in these elections.
Since we are here, let's talk about another aspect. A lot has been said about, you know, vote cutters. Is that the case in the Bihar Assembly election as well?
When you say about vote cutters, first, let's talk about LJP. Yes, LJP has performed a role of the vote cutters. They managed to win just one assembly seat, but they were instrumental in damaging the electoral prospects of JDU in very large number of constituencies. And when I say large number of constituencies, these are not large to the extent of, say, 30-40 constituencies, but they damaged JDU's prospects in about, say, 10-15 seats. And if these seats have gone in favor of JDU, if LJP was the alliance partner, things would have been very, very different for NDA. If we look at other smaller parties, which are normally referred as the vote katwas, many of them have not played the role of vote katwa. Some do. Some certainly played the role of vote katwa. The two smaller parties which you mentioned, Hindustani Awam Morcha and Vikasshil Insaf Party, they are alliance of NDA and they managed to perform very well, 4 seats each. If you look at the AIMIM, which was seen as a vote katwa in the Simanchal region because of their popularity among the Muslim vote, but they ended up winning 5 seats. There are other parties which may have worked as vote katwas. BSP did not perform well, RSP did not perform well, Pappu Yadav's party did not perform well. So these parties may have performed the role of vote katwa, but large number of smaller parties did perform well in these elections.
Absolutely. Even you're left right. Go ahead. Please continue. Please complete your point.
Even there was speculation what kind of a role left parties are going to play in these elections. But look at their performance. They have also performed very well. And left parties, if we look at their presence in Bihar politics, they are also seen as a very small party in Bihar.
Absolutely. We'll talk about left politics in just a bit. But Nisula, let me bring you into the picture now and talk about Nitish Kumar. You know, his party contesting in 115 seats, winning only 43. What does this mean for the political future of Nitish Kumar? And what does it mean for him in the seat of the chief minister? Do you believe that there are going to be pulls and pressures?
Well, there's certainly going to be pulls and pressures within the BJP. There's always been a very sizable number of people within the BJP who have always felt that BJP is not getting what its due is in the NDA in Bihar, which is to get the top job. And now that there is such a huge difference in seats between the JDU and the BJP, it was being felt that this was the time to stake a claim to the top job. But there have been promises made through the campaign, and also to mitigate some of the ill effects of what Chirag Paswan was attempting to do, and to, you know, mitigate all of those things. So the chief minister's chair has been promised to Mr. Nitish Kumar. But let me tell you that the relationship between these two long-time allies is going to be a very contested, very difficult one to negotiate now. I don't think Mr. Kumar is at all happy with his tally being brought down because of Chirag Paswan. There are people in the JDU who feel that, you know, the BJP could have acted firmer with Chirag Paswan and try to persuade him far more forcefully to stay within the NDA and not do what he ended up doing, which is that reducing Mr. Nitish Kumar's tally. There are all these pulls and pressures which are happening within the
Absolutely. I'll come back to you for another reaction really on this and what is going to be the first order of the day as far as the chief minister is concerned. But Sunil Chaudhary, let me bring you into the picture and go back to a point that Sanjay was making earlier in the program in his introductory remarks about, you know, the resurgence of sorts of the left parties in Bihar. What does this mean? Because, you know, the left parties have not done well, you know, in this part of the country for some time now. So, are we seeing a resurgence of sorts?
In fact, let me just come back to, before coming back to left parties, let me see Bihar elections 2020 from three different perspectives. A, like, it's basically the bipolar contest. When I say it's a bipolar contest, it was mainly contest between, say, Rashtriya Gathbandhan, that is NDA, and Mahagathbandhan, that is led by RJD, Congress, and others. So these two polls were the focus of attention throughout these three phases of elections. The left parties, where they are placed, I mean, they do not become very significant in the course of the elections. Secondly, besides bipolar, it is also bi-generational elections in the sense that two generations were contesting specifically for the post of chief minister. It was basically the old guards, Nitish and other his cohorts, and the young Turks led by Tejaswi Yadav, Chirag Paswan and others. So from that perspective, we can see that the left parties do not come play a very significant role here in this context as well. And third, we would say, besides bipolar and bi-generational, it was also a bi-transformational contest. When I say bi-transformational contest, it was also a contest between the pro-changers who wanted who didn't want a change in the chief minister positions, and the no-changers. So It used to happen that people were talking about that Nitishji is having a Tina. There is no alternative. And Tina was replaced with Tejaswi Yadav's very fervent appeal, which could be seen in Israelis. It was Tia. That is, Tejaswi is an alternative. So from these three perspectives, like, the contest was mostly between Mahagathbandhan and National Democratic Alliance. Yes, the left played a very significant, very strategical role while making alliance with them, and the number of seats for which they contested, they actually won it. So they won it not on the basis of contesting elections alone as the left front, but as a part of Mahagathbandhan. So that could bring them, and they have realized that over the years since 2014, that the left base, especially from Tripura, Kerala, and Tamil Nadu, had started receding. You can see that in 2014-2019, that left in Tamil Nadu and Kerala got significant number of vote shares, which got transformed in terms of seats. It was only on the basis of their alliance coming, all the left parties coming together as a part of alliance.
Right. Okay. Nisula, let me go back to the points that you are making, of course, you know, as far as the pulls and pressures for Nitish Kumar are concerned, and also, what's going to be the first order of the day, really, once the new government is formed?
No, first of all, the BJP will have to hold a parliamentary board meeting. We are hearing that it might be this evening because Prime Minister Narendra Modi is expected to visit the party headquarters today, etc. And I think after the parliamentary board kind of endorses the whole this thing and appoints central observers, sends them across, those are the formal kind of things. What is strange, Frank, right now is that although Prime Minister Narendra Modi, Home Minister Amit Shah, BJP President JP Nadda all claimed victory last night close to midnight, but they did once, you know, the numbers were very clear. Till now, till at least 16 hours after all of that, the man who's supposed to be the chief minister has not said a single word, released a single statement, sent a single thank you to the people of Bihar for re-electing, you know, his government. None of that has come through. So Mr. Kumar is said to be engaged in meetings in his residence. And therefore, we are actually quite in the dark about how things are going to proceed. What we do know is that the formal steps start from the BJP parliamentary board meeting, then his own, Mr. Kumar's own internal party meeting. And let's see what further steps are taken.
Okay. All right. So, Sanjay Kumar, you know, if you look at the election as a whole, several pollsters got it wrong. Was it a difficult election to call? What were the factors in play?
Any state which witnessed a bipolar, multipolar contest, even though there, Sunil mentioned that there were two big polls, in a sense, one Mahagathbandhan and one NDA. But besides that also, there were two other alliances. One was an alliance of Upendra Kushwaha's party, AIMIM was part of that, and BSP was part of that. There was another alliance, Pappu Yadav's Jan Adhikar party, and he had formed an alliance with few other parties. And there were large number of independents. Independents always contest in elections, whichever state goes to poll or in the Lok Sabha elections. So if you have a bipolar contest, completely bipolar contest, it becomes relatively easier for any pollster to make estimates of vote and then convert votes into seats. Converting votes into seats is always tricky, always difficult in the first past the post system. In this multi-cornered contest, it becomes far more difficult to make assessment about votes. And look at the present scenario. The two alliances have got equal number of votes, exactly equal number of votes. But one Gathbandhan is a winner and the other Gathbandhan would be sitting in the opposition. So even if as a pollster, you get the vote estimates absolutely right, even then there is no guarantee that you are going to convert these votes into seats in a very, very professional. You will do it in a professional manner, but whether you are going to get it right or not, it becomes very difficult. And it becomes very difficult because of the first past the post system. Large number of constituencies may have been decided by small number of votes. And if smaller number of constituencies which has been won by smaller number of votes are in favor of one alliance or one party, then this whole vote sheet conversion becomes very, very difficult.
Absolutely. All right. Sunil, let's talk about another aspect now. You know, the BJP also seems to have done really, really well in Bihar. You know, many people did not expect the BJP to do so well. Votes seem to have been garnered in the name of Prime Minister Narendra Modi. So clearly, Prime Minister Modi's image and also his persona as a vote puller or a vote getter has not diminished.
You're right, but I think besides Prime Minister Modi's incredible image and his flagship programs, I think BJP as a strong political organization has marched ahead to all nooks and corners of the state. For past three elections, you can see that BJP has started strengthening its organizational groups all across the state. And secondly, when we say that, yes, you can see the success of BJP all across India. So one important factor could be definitely Prime Minister Narendra Modi. But here it was resurgence of BJP as a national party. It was trying to replace the regional political parties in different parts of the country. So it was more the resurgence of BJP, which could have attributed to the success of the party in the elections. But I would also say that number of factors which added to the strength and success of BJP in these state elections, the many programs which actually attracted the women voters, especially all those schemes of Sunandha Yojana and Jandhan Yojana, and these were the flagship programs where women were the most household beneficiary. So women voters, active participation, and you can see that Bihar is a state where people, where voters are very, very politically motivated and politically oriented. So the literacy and educational difference doesn't make much difference here in the context of Bihar. Thirdly, I would still say that Nitishji's working ex Sushasan Babu and his way of governance in terms of development, infrastructural development, and his accessibility to all parts of the country, and this is the incredible image in terms of the safe and secure state, contributed a lot. And finally, I would say that besides the BJP, the Prime Minister Modi's and Nitish Kumar's the very clean image, it could have been the contribution by all those karamchari, adhikaris and vyaparis, which might have seen the clean governance of Nitish Kumar in past 1.5 decades, that could have contributed to the success of BJP and JDU as part of NDA. I would give credit to both BJP and NDA emerging as a real alternative in Bihar elections 2020.
Absolutely. Talking about the factors that have influenced these polls, I'll come back to that in just a bit and I'll take that up with Sanjay. But before that, you know, Nisula, as far as Tejaswi is concerned, young leader, still a long way to go really as far as politics is concerned, has done reasonably well, considerably well really in this particular assembly election, you know, kept his parents away from campaigning, you know, didn't speak too much about them. He also spoke about, for his main focus area was, you know, job creation and talking about how he's going to give 10 lakh jobs, and you know, those were his focus areas. So what lies ahead really as far as Tejaswi is concerned?
Well, if he's a very sharp politician, which he seems to have demonstrated during this election, apart from the fact that he allowed himself to get dragged down by the Congress and its bad performance, he will try and become that transcendent leader who can go beyond the MY combination. As Sanjayji said in the first response to your question, that, you know, this was not supposed to be an election where caste combinations, it was going to be, you know, an election beyond caste. Maybe, you know, the young voters would have done something, but it ended up being, you know, both formations being very much within the straitjacket of their own caste arithmetic. And whoever had the more appealing or wider based social coalition, they managed to carry the day. So if in future, if Tejaswi Yadav manages to broad-base his social coalition and escape being straitjacketed only into the MY combination, that would be a good way for him to proceed, because, you know, a lot of people also said that a counter-polarization took place precisely because Tejaswi Yadav's rallies were so well attended. A lot of people who had not very happy memories of his father's rule looked at, you know, the communities that were attending Tejaswi's rallies and felt scared that, you know, there would be a return of some sort of a jungle raj or, you know, whatever. So he needs to cut away from all that rather more comprehensively. And whoever has, in Indian politics, especially in Bihar, etc., whoever has the broadest social coalition and also manages to get the floating voter, people who haven't decided, who look at you as a credible alternative, you know, you that person will get elected to power. That has been behind the success of every successful politician in this country. And therefore, he needs to break the straitjacket of his father's vote bank. His father also used to manage to get a lot of floating voters in the past. Those were, of course, wooed away from him by Mr. Nitish Kumar through his Mahadalit and EBC and all those voters. He managed to get, you know, non-Yadav OBC separated and et cetera, Now he needs, now Tejaswi needs to broad-base and make it a more umbrella organization, the RJD.
Right. Okay, taking the discussion forward now. So, Sanjay, you know, as far as, you know, where do you think this election was really won or lost? One big factor.
I think it was saved by BJP. It, at one point of time, it looked like as if Mahagathbandhan is all set to win this election. When I say it was saved by BJP for NDA, because look at the performance of BJP. If Prime Minister Modi had not campaigned aggressively, if he had not been able to attract the voters, and if BJP had not performed so well, I think this election would have been lost by NDA. And for making it a contest, I think the credit should go to Tejaswi. He really put up a very coherent campaign. He kept his focus on the two issues which dominated the election campaign, which was of Berojgari and Vikas. Vikas and Berojgari, development and unemployment. So the echo around these two issues was so much that even people who were not very enthusiastic about voting for young Tejaswi because of, you know, the old memories of Jangal Raj, etc., some of them started thinking of him as a serious alternative. And as the campaign moved ahead, Tejaswi started getting more and more appeal, and he actually made it a contest. So, but contest to only to the extent of coming very close to the victory mark, not crossing that magic figure.
Right. So, Sunil, you know, as far as this election is concerned, is it likely to have any kind of ramifications on the national level on several important polls that are to come up next year?
Yeah, Sanjay ji has rightly stated that the issues of development and employment as part of governance, that would move beyond governance. It would be now a contest for good governance. So parties need to focus on the issues of good governance, how they actually deliver at the grassroots level. Nitish ji got judged on the basis of his agenda of governance in the first three decades. Now, if the people have given mandate to him and the BJP, now he would be judged on the basis of the actual delivery at the grassroots level, specifically in the context of the employment issue. And I still hope that in the days to come, people have really become very, very awakened and cautious about their right, and the parties have to get themselves well connected with the voters. You cannot take voters for granted, whether they're young voters or they're old voters. The voters play a very significant role, and that the issues of populism, primordialism, which used to dominate electoral politics, specifically in these states. So we are now moving beyond primordialism and moving towards governance and good governance. So the issues of development, governance, employment, actual delivery at the grassroots level are going to determine the poll prospects of parties in the years to come.
And Disula, is there a political message in this? What's the political message that's coming out of the verdict of the Bihar Assembly polls?
One, that caste politics cannot be undermined. You need to broaden social coalitions, etc., etc. Secondly, that Prime Minister Modi has encapsulated within his own leadership style both the enabler model and the provider model, which is, you know, the enabler model is basically empowering marginal communities to find a space in the system, which he has done. The BJP has taken a very decisive kind of shift towards OBCs. He's also become the provider in terms of the welfare goods and things like that, which used to be the USP of the Congress in the past. So there were a lot of state elections that the BJP had lost. There was a lot of talk that he, Prime Minister Modi, is very good for the national elections, but maybe not so much for the state assemblies. Maybe that needs to be revisited just for a little bit. But BJP also needs to strengthen its state leadership, because there was a lot of murmurings against their state leadership, even through the campaign. Thirdly, one big, big message for the opposition parties, which are likely to go into polls, big regional parties going into polls next year in Tamil Nadu and in West Bengal, people who are parties which are exploring or are already in alliance with the Congress on doing a very realistic assessment on how many seats that they need to give or cede to the Congress, because that could pull the whole, that could pull the whole total down, which happened with Tejaswi Yadav. We had an interview with Deepankar from the CPIML, which did very well in the Bihar elections, where he plainly said that Congress was given just far too many seats. And if 50-50 seats had been given to both the left front and the Congress, probably the Mahagathbandhan could have pushed past the finish line. You know, there has to be a realistic assessment on the strengths of alliance partners when you go in. I think those are some of the lessons that are pretty much to be taken. And last mile delivery for Prime Minister Modi's programs and policies are working, and people are responding to it. And he is creating support bases which were not there with the BJP in the past, namely very marginal communities, the poor, the rural poor, and women.
Right. Okay. Time to get quick closing comments from all my panelists with the best way forward. I've got limited time, so I'm going to ask you to be brief, starting first with you, Sanjay Kumar.
See, we are talking about what are the implications of the verdict of Bihar elections for the national politics. My own sense is that every politics have got bifurcated if you look at the national politics and the state politics. There was a time when state politics had the verdict in state politics had its impact on the national politics. I think if we look at the verdict during last, say, couple of years, voters have started making a clear distinction. When they vote for the national to elect the national government, they vote differently. And when they vote to elect the state government, they vote differently. We have seen this in Bihar, in Haryana, in Jharkhand, in Delhi, and in other states in the recent times. I think I would not like to draw think of larger implications of Bihar verdict into the national politics, because national politics would still be played in a different way compared to the state politics. So I think the state assembly elections should be seen with the prism of local issues, etc. And I don't see these elections having any impact on the national elections, which is still far away.
Right. Sunil Chaudhary, what next?
Yeah, I think the regional variations do have a role to play at the regional level, especially in the state politics. But I think one could see broad convergence between regional variations and national variations. So I think in the days to come, in the years to come, you have to have a convergence between state politics and national politics. And secondly, I would still believe that unless you focus on the main planks of good governance, unless you deliver at grassroots level, you cannot think of winning all elections, right, from the panchayat elections to state assembly elections and to the national elections. And I think the success of the parties there in the state of Bihar broadly proved that those the legislators who have been working in their constituencies for consecutively three elections, so they have won it. So actually, those who work, they actually get paid by they can get paid by the voters in the election. So you have to deliver and get paid back by the voters in the elections.
Absolutely, all right. And Nisula Ebbar, close the show for us with your concluding remarks.
Well, I do believe what Sanjayji said was more or less true in terms of India having discovered a split ticket voting, which is that, you know, you vote differently in the national and you also vote differently in, you know, state assembly elections. Having said that, most elections and most political parties need to now also concentrate on a lot of the parties that didn't end up doing very well, who had some momentum but ended up not doing well. Mostly it's the party organization which fails them, you know, at the last mile. Secondly, I believe very strongly that we have entered a third party system in this country where BJP is the dominant pole, and you have a lot of strong regional parties which are providing the primary challenge to the BJP. And Congress is attaching itself, you know, to these strong regional parties, except in a few states where there is a direct fight between the BJP and the Congress. Therefore, I firmly believe that a lot of regional parties who are exploring or are already in alliance with the Congress will be looking at the Bihar Assembly election results very closely on just how much adjustment to make, how many seats to concede, et cetera, et cetera. So these are some of the things that I feel will impact the next round of polls, which is, I think, Tamil Nadu, West Bengal, and Assam.
All right. On that note, then, I'll call it a wrap on this edition of The Big Picture. Thank you to all my guests for joining me on the program and putting things into perspective for us. Well, that's it on this edition of The Big Picture. See you again next time.